Praise the Lord, everybody. God bless you, and I'm glad that you're tuned in tonight. We're going to have a wonderful time in the Word of God. Fasten your seatbelt. We're going to be talking about some good things that I believe is going to be a blessing to everyone, but it's also going to put you in a position where you need to think about some things. Let's go over in the prayer, and then we'll get right into the Word. Father, we thank you again for this opportunity to come before you. Thank you for what you have done already, and thank you for what you are doing at this moment, for what you will do momentarily. Thank you for utterance in the Holy Ghost, that I may speak according to the perfect plan and will of God, that only that which is ordained of you will come forth in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for ministering to your people according to your will. Thank you for eyes being opened, the eyes of our understanding being enlightened, in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the word. Thank you for what it will do in us, what it will do for us, what it will do to us, and even what it will do through us as we yield. Thank you, Lord, for causing those that you desire to hear being on this live in the name of Jesus. We thank you and we give you praise for it. In Jesus' name, amen. I believe that things are going to be different for you. I think this may be, in some respects, a life-changing experience. You know, because of the this COVID-19 and all of the things, all of the changes that the world has gone through as a result of it, many people have been asking a lot of questions. You know, is this the end? Is this what's getting ready to happen next? And a lot of people are, you know, really afraid or concerned about what's happening. Some are wondering, you know, does this mean Jesus is coming soon and all of that? Well, yes, he is coming soon. But there's a lot of interest in those kinds of things as a result. And I was thinking about some of these things recently. And I thought about what's going to happen. I mean, when I say what's going to happen, when I'm not going to talk about the tribulation and all those things right now. I just want to talk about what's going to happen with us and we that are born again believers. What happens? I mean, when you die and then when the Lord returns in the what we call the rapture, what's going to happen? And I want to go over to just talk about a couple of those things. First of all, we already know that, and if you don't, let me tell you that every person, the Bible said to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. That's for those who are born again, of course. And there's only two destinations. There's only two places an individual can go. All humans that die, we are spirit beings. We have soul, and really your soul and spirit are inseparable. And we live inside of this physical body. At the time of death, there is going to be a separation. And that's what the Bible is talking about when it talks about death. It's not talking about annihilation or ceasing to exist. It's talking about a separation. And I've talked about that quite a bit in the past. But when a person dies physically, their spirit and soul is separated from their body. The person does not cease to exist. You are an eternal being on the inside, and that will never change. Your physical body is simply the house, if you will, that you live in while you are here. But the real you is inside of this body, and that person, the real you, the spirit, does not die. The spirit and soul does not die. It does not fall asleep. It does not die. It does not cease to exist. It doesn't go into a state of unconsciousness or anything like that. You are always alive. You're always aware. Your spirit is, your spirit. As a matter of fact, even when you and I are sleeping, our spirit doesn't sleep. It does not sleep. So you're not, you know, it's not sleep, it's alive. So really, when a person dies, when you separate from your body, you leave your body, but you're still you, You still have your personality and everything else. And you go to the place that you chose, that is appointed for you as a result of your own choice. You say, well, what do you mean my own choice? In other words, there's only two destinations. You can go to heaven or you can go to hell. Now, you don't hear a lot of preaching about that or teaching about that these days, but it's still true. There is a heaven, there is a hell, and you're going to go to one of them. And what determines whether or not you go to which one you go to determines it's determined by what you do with Jesus, what you do about Jesus. Jesus said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man come to the Father but by me. So no one can come to God except through the Lord Jesus Christ. And then over in the book of Acts, it tells us, I believe it's the fourth chapter, tells us that there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. There's only one name. That name is Jesus. So if you don't come through the name of Jesus, then, or you know, you don't come through him, then you don't come at all. And now God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. He gave Jesus, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but shall have everlasting life. That's what God wants. That's what he desires. Shall have everlasting life. And then that's John 3:16. Verse 17 says, for God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. It is God's will for the world to be saved. 2 Peter 3:9 says, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Now, all of that shows us that it is the perfect will of God for us all to be saved. By the way, if you go back to John 3:16, you know, John chapter 3, we quoted 16 and 17, and the scripture says in the 18th verse, he that believeth not is condemned already. See, God doesn't condemn you. He doesn't send his son to condemn you. But whoever does not believe is condemned already because he have not believed in the only begotten Son of God. So if you do not believe in the Son of God, if you do not believe in Christ, if you do, when I say believe in him, I do not mean believe in his existence, believe in him in a historical manner, but I mean believe on him as your Lord and Savior. You have to trust him as your Savior. You have to receive him as your Lord and Savior. If you do not do that, then you are lost. There's no such thing as being born a Christian. You're not born a Christian because you came up, you're born in a Christian household, because you went to church all the time. Mama or grandma made you go to church and all of that. That doesn't make you a Christian. It doesn't make you a Christian. No more than standing in a park makes you a tree. No, something has to be done. We are children of God, not because we're human. We're children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. That's the only way you become a child of God. You have to be, is through faith in Christ Jesus. I know that religion says that we're all God's children. You hear people say that all the time, but they didn't get that from the Bible. They didn't get that from the Bible. There's not the brotherhood of man and the fatherhood of God. God is not the father of every person. As a matter of fact, he's only the father of those who receive Jesus as Lord and Savior. That's how he becomes your father. So now, that's something we need to understand. However, we need to also understand that God does not control what we decide to do. It's up to us. He doesn't force himself on any of us. He doesn't make us get saved. No one can pray a prayer that forces us to be saved. No one can give money to some preacher or organization to and have group prayer and all that, and we're going to get saved because everybody's praying for us and so forth. You know, you can't go around saying, well, I know my mama, or my daddy, or my grandmama, or somebody is praying for me, so I'm not ready right now, but I'm going to get saved after a while. I know I am because they're praying for me. That's foolish. and their praying is not going to make you get saved. Your receiving Christ is an act of your own will. It is an act of your will. Now, those who refuse to receive him, and there are many people who say, I'm not ready yet. I want to live my life first, you know, when I get older, you know, all kinds of things. And regrettably, sometimes people say that and die before they get older, and they're lost if they have not received Christ. There's no prayer that anyone can pray for you or about you that changes your destiny once your spirit and soul leaves your body. Once you leave, that's it. You're gone. Praise God. Now, I know there are people that have had experiences, what they call near-death experiences, where they left their body for a short period of time. But once you leave permanently, that's it. There's no second chance. You're gone. Now, once that happens, you're either going to heaven to be with Jesus, or you're going to hell. It's that simple. You're going to one of those places. But I want to talk to Christians. I want to talk to believers, because those of us that are in Christ, when he returns in what we call the rapture, he comes to take his church, not the second coming of Christ, but the rapture, or what we call the second advent. The second advent would be like the second coming. But the rapture is not the second coming. That's when the Lord is going to stand in the middle of the air and the church is going to be caught up to meet him. Now, every person who has died, every person who died, first of all, let me say this. Every person who died in the Old Testament with faith in the Christ that was to come went to a place called paradise. And it's also called Abraham's bosom. And it was down in the earth, the lower part of the earth, under the earth. Okay. Now, from Jesus after he was resurrected, because he's the first, the firstborn, as it were, as far as resurrection is concerned. And so he gets up. After him, from that point on, every believer that trusts him goes up. Paradise is no longer under the earth. Paradise is now in heaven, and everyone goes up immediately. Now, however, we do not receive our rewards at that time. You hear people talking about they're going on to their reward. Well, they are, in the sense that their work is finished. But they're not going to their reward in the sense of they're going to go and receive a reward. Nobody has received their rewards as of yet. No one. Going to heaven is not the reward. There's going to be rewards given in heaven for the work we have done, which we're going to look at something in just a couple minutes here. But no one has received their rewards as of yet, including Paul, Peter, John, anybody. No one has received their reward. They are all in heaven, fellowshipping with Jesus and with one another. Praise God, but they are not, they have not received the reward. That is going to happen at what a thing called the judgment seat of Christ. At the judgment seat of Christ, we're all going to be judged. That's what it's called. It's called the judgment seat of Christ. Now, the thing about this judgment seat, this place, you need to understand that this judgment seat, which is also called the Bema seat, this judgment seat is where we are going to stand before the Lord in heaven and give an account of ourselves. That is all the work, everything that you've done since you were born again. Now, the great news is that all your sins from the past are completely gone. So he's not going to drum up the sins and all those things that you committed and before you became a believer and all of that. He's not going to drum that up. In fact, even the sins you've committed since being born again is covered under the blood of Jesus. The Bible says if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. However, there is something we're going to stand before him and give an account about. And that is our lives and what we did with our lives and how we lived our lives for him. And the biggest thing and the main thing, one of the main things is, did you live according to his plan? God has a plan for every one of us. He has a plan. He has a reason. There's a purpose for you being here. No one on earth is here without a purpose. God has a purpose for you. God has a plan for you. That does not mean it's going to happen. His plan and his purpose may never come to pass. It has to do with you. God needs something from you and me in order for him to have his way in our lives. And what he needs is our permission, and he needs our participation. God is not going to do something against our will and without us participating with him. We have to cooperate with God in order for his will to be done. There's no such thing as just praying, Lord, your will be done, and we just lay around and do nothing. We have to be led by the Holy Spirit, and we need to seek God about his plan and his will for our lives. I want to read a scripture to you, a couple of scriptures to you, and then we're going to look at something about that I was speaking. First of all, go to Jeremiah chapter 1. I'm reading out of my book called Determining Divine Direction, How to Know When God is Leading You. And in Jeremiah 1, verses 4 and 5, listen what the word says. Then the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee and ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. Now, obviously, he didn't ordain every person a prophet, but it is true that he did know. Just like he knew Jeremiah, he knew you, me, and everyone else before we were even formed in the belly. I mean, when you were nothing yet. Praise God. Amen. When God already knew you, that is, he had knowledge of you, of what he had for you, what he wanted to happen for you. Praise God. All of that is true. Now, I want you to look at this 139th Psalm. Psalm 139 and 16. Listen to what the psalmist said. I'm going to read it out of the first. I'll read out the New American Standard Bible. Thine eyes have seen my unformed substance. My unformed substance. And in thy book, they were all written, the days that were ordained for me, when as yet there was not one of them. Before a single day had passed, God had your life all written in the book. Before a single day had passed. I'm going to read it in the Amplified Bible. Your eyes saw my unformed substance, and in your book, all the days of my life were written. Before ever they took shape, when as yet there was none of them. Before your day of birth, before anything happened, before you were formed in the belly, before it was a full body, God already knew you and had a plan for you and a purpose for you. And what's interesting to me, God is awesome. What's interesting to me is that it doesn't matter. The circumstances of your birth does not matter. Even if people came into this earth through somebody sinning, it doesn't matter. God, in his foreknowledge, understood what was going to happen. He saw what was going to happen, and he knew what was coming, and he made a plan. You see, God has a way even though he didn't plan the sin, he didn't plan anybody to do wrong, but because of his foreknowledge, because he knew what was going to happen, he had a plan for that child. Praise God. For their life. He has something for them. There is a purpose. Praise God for them. Now, when we stand before the Lord Jesus Christ, we're going to have to give an account to him of ourselves before him. And we're going to have to answer things about our lives. Now, let me just read a little something else to you that I want you to understand. That is, we have a divine destiny and a divine purpose for being here on the earth. And our purpose for living can only be defined by our Maker, who is the Lord. He determines how the thing made ought to be used. That's God. That's for him. For example, if I took a chair and set a plant in it, the chair would be able to hold the plant, but it would not be reaching its full potential because that is not what it was made for. If I took a plant stand and put the plant on it, then the plant stand would be reaching its full potential because that is what it was made for. If I sat on the plant stand, it may hold me, but it would eventually become uncomfortable for me because that is not what it's made for. However, if I sat in a chair, I would be sitting comfortably, having a support for my body because that is what the chair is made for. In the same way, only God can determine, can define our purpose. And he determines what our purpose is. We don't make that determination on our own. We don't make that determination on our own. When people make their own determination as to what their purpose is, they may have some limited success in what they do, but their full potential is not realized. There are certain purposes that we all have alike. However, we don't all have the same course. God has a different plan, a different purpose, a different course for us. The fulfillment of our destiny is determined by our being used by God for the purpose for which we are here. Praise God. You, me, or anyone else will never have fulfillment until you are doing what you were destined to do. Or in other words, you are doing what God has planned for you to do. Now, we read there in the 139th Psalm about all of our days and all of that, and our life was written in a book. So really what God did was he wrote out your entire life. That is his plan and his purpose for your life, and wrote it all out from the beginning to the very end. He sees the end at the beginning. He knows everything. He knows what you're going to do. He know what you're going to think. He know what you're going to say. He know where you're going to go. He know who's going with you. It tells him he knows. He knows. Praise God. And so, but just because he has something written out does not mean it's going to happen like he has it written out. Because what happens is, as we seek him and we receive Christ and we become believers and so forth, and we start seeking God. Many Christians don't see God at all. They don't have a clue about what God has for them at all. They're not asking God anything about it. What is my purpose? What do you want me to do? Nothing. They're just living, doing whatever they want to do. And then they think that at the end, you know, they're going to get some great reward because they're saved. Well, listen, that's not going to give you a great reward. Now, thank God, being in heaven is great. That's wonderful. Praise God. But there are other things that's going to happen, other things we're going to receive. And it's according to what we've done. And really, it's according to what he wrote in his book concerning us. And if we followed him and followed his will, This is why I believe that, you know, one of the most important subjects in the Bible is learning how to be led by the Spirit of God. I don't think after learning faith, because, you know, without faith, it's impossible to please him. And we live by faith, we walk by faith, we receive things from him by faith and all that. But after that, I think the most important subject, the important thing we need to learn is how to be led by the Spirit of God, how to know when he's leading us. And the reason why that's important is that God will always, and I mean always, lead us in line with his will. He's going to lead us in line with what's written in the book. Praise God. That's how he's going to lead you. He's not going to lead you according to any other thing. His plan, his will, his purpose, what he has decided, what he has designed, what he has determined, this is how he leads us. Now, we don't always go according to how he leads us. And very often, we don't go that way because we have no idea when he's leading us. Many, many people have no clue about God leading us. No clue. I'm here, and let's go to Romans 14 for a minute. Romans chapter 14, I'm going to look at it. And I want to read something to you just to bring to you the fact that we have to stand before the Lord. Romans chapter 14. Praise God. I want to start at verse 10. But why dost thou judge thy brother? Or why dost thou set at naught thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. We shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Turn to 2 Corinthians 5. Now, not only are we going to all stand before the judgment seat of Christ, we're not going to stand there as a group. You're not going to stand there as a family. You're going to stand, we must all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians 5. Praise God. And let's read verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. Now listen, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he have done, whether it be good or bad. I want to read that from the Amplified Bible. For we must all appear and be revealed as we are before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive his pay according to what he has done in the body, whether good or evil, considering what his purpose and motive have been, and what he has achieved, been busy with, and given himself and his attention to accomplishing. Man, that sounds good. I want to say that one more time. For we must all appear and be revealed as we are before the judgment seat of Christ. You're going to be revealed as you are before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive his pay according to what he has done in his body since you was born again, whether good or evil, considering what his purpose and motive have been and what he has achieved, been busy with, and given himself and his attention to accomplishing. There are people who sense a call in their life. They know that God has something for them to do, and that's it. They're not doing anything about fulfilling it. They're not seeking him. They're not trying to figure out what they're supposed to do. They're not cooperating with him at all. Such people are going to stand before the Lord Jesus and give an account, and they're going to suffer a loss. Now let's go over to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Here's where it gets deep. 1 Corinthians 3. That's the kind of stuff that Christians don't want to talk about. But we must. We must. Let's start at verse 8. Now he that planteth and he that watereth are one, and every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. See, that goes in line with what it said there. You'll get your own reward according to your own labor. It's not going to be any y'all, us, and we, and them. Every man is going to receive according to his own labor. Did you get that? You're going to receive your own reward according to your own labor. So, for instance, whatever God had for you to do, that's your work. That's your labor. If you do that, and if you do it faithfully, you're going to receive a reward for that. But if you're not doing what God said, even if you're doing some other work that you call the work of the Lord, you're still going to suffer loss. Let's keep reading. It says in verse 9, for we are laborers together with God, ye are God's husbandry, ye are God's building. According to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. Now listen to this. If any man's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. Now, who's going to receive the reward? Anybody whose work abide, remain after the test, after God tested it. If your reward remain, your work remain, you'll receive a reward. Verse 15, if any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss in heaven. He shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. I want to read that in the Amplified Bible. According to the grace, the special endowment for my task of God bestowed on me, like a skillful architect and master builder, I laid the foundation, and now another man is building upon it. But let each man be careful how he builds upon it. For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is already laid, which is Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One. So Jesus is the foundation. He is it, and it's all about him. Everything we do for him. You know, it's a old song that used to say, only what you do for Christ will last. That is absolutely true. Because everything, he's the foundation. Everything is being built on him. Everything is being built on him. What he has desired, what he has called, what he has said, what his work is. Now, a lot of people do a lot of things in the name of the Lord, but it's not him. And it's not what he has designed for them. And therefore, in such a case, they will not receive a reward. And that's very interesting, because I'm going to get to something in just a minute that I find extremely interesting. He says, for no other foundation can anyone lay that is than that which is laid, already laid, which is Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One. Now, verse 12.
But if anyone builds upon the foundation, whether it be with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, the work of each one will become plainly, openly known. Now let me stop to say something. These six categories that I just referred to are the six categories under which all of us are going to be judged. All of your work is going to fall under one of these categories. Everything you've done as a Christian is going to fall under one of these categories. It's either going to be a work of gold, silver, precious stones, which are, you know, diamonds and stuff, wood, hay, or straw. Now, let's take wood, hay, or straw, or wood, hay, or stubble, whatever you, whichever way you want to say it. What happens when fire is put to wood? It burns. What happens when fire is put to hay? It burns. Stubble. It burns. But fire put to gold, silver, or precious stone doesn't burn it. It doesn't destroy it. But it does destroy wood, hay, and straw. Now, every person, whatever work it is that you do, is going to fall under one of these categories. A part of what's going to be involved in determining what kind of work it is the purpose. Was it God's will? Was it His plan? What was your purpose in doing what you did? What was your heart motive? There's a lot of things that go into what He's going to look at. A lot of people do a lot of things and they say they're doing it in the name of the Lord, but it's not going to count. It doesn't count because their motive was impure. Their motive was impure. For, give you a quick example. The Bible talks about giving, for instance. It says, give and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that you meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. Now that's just one. It's a several other passages of scripture that deals with giving. The Lord talked about laying up treasures here on earth. And don't lay up treasures here, but lay up treasures there. What He's trying to tell us is there's a twofold reward through our giving. When we give, I like the way I heard someone else say it some years ago. The gift leaves your hands, but it doesn't leave your life because it's working for you. It's working for you. I don't mean as like an investment in the stock market. This is better than that. It's working for you in that everything that that money was used for in the kingdom of God, every soul that was saved, every sick body that was healed, everyone that heard the gospel, those who supported that, those who gave to that, will receive a return on their giving here. But also, when they stand before the Lord Jesus Christ, they're going to receive a reward for what they did. That's a part of what they did. However, if someone gave an offering with the wrong motivation, even it wouldn't matter how much they gave. They could give $1 million or 10 million. It wouldn't matter how much they gave. If their heart motive is wrong, then it's not going to count for them. See, that's going to be a work of wood, hay, or straw. That's one of the things He's going to consider. What you did is one thing. The motive of your heart is a whole nother thing. Sometimes people give so that they can be seen of men. Sometimes people give because they want the accolades that go along with giving. They want their name to be recognized. And matter of fact, some, if their name is not recognized, you know, they get upset about it. Some people, if you don't talk about their giving, they go home and they start talking about it. They tell everybody they can about how much they gave to the work of God, how much they give to church and all of that. Well, Jesus said, when you do that, you have your reward. So they already have their reward. If you're going around bragging about how much you've given, that's your reward. Your reward is whatever, you know, the pat on the back that you get from the people that you're bragging to. That's your reward. Jesus said that. We can look into that later. Not today. But that's what Jesus said. you have your reward. So we can't do things to be seen of men. You can be doing a great work, what we would call a great work. You could be doing, you know, winning people and God is blessing people, but you're doing it for a reputation, or you doing it so people can pat you on the back, or you doing it, whatever your motive is that is inconsistent with God, with his word, with what he wants, with his will, then it will not count. It doesn't count. Now let's go back and finish reading this. Verse 13, the work of each one will become plainly, openly known, shown for what it is. For the day of Christ will disclose and declare it, because it will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test and critically appraise the character and worth of the work each person has done. God is going to take your work, all that you've done, because it's written in books. It's written. And he's going to take all that you have done, and he's going to appraise it. He's going to see what your motive was, why you did it, what your heart was like, and all of those kinds of things. Because when it's not done for his glory, it's done in vain. When it's not done for his glory, it's done in vain. Anything that we do that's not done for his glory is done in vain. I'm going to come back and tell you an experience I had along those lines. But now, notice this. I want to read that verse again. I'm reading the Amplified Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 3. I'm starting at verse 13 again. The work of each one will become plainly, openly known. So whatever your work is, when you stand before Jesus, it's going to be known. Okay? It's going to be shown for what it is. For the day of Christ will disclose and declare it, because it will be revealed with fire. And the fire will test and critically appraise the character and worth of the work each person has done. Listen, if the work which any person has built on this foundation, any product of its efforts, whatever, survives this test, he will get his reward. But if any person's work is burned up under the test, he will suffer the loss of it all, losing his reward. Though he himself will be saved, but only as one who has passed through the fire. I call that saved by the hairs. You just made it in by the hairs of your chinny chin chin. That's what I call that. Now, I want you to think about something. Now, a lot of people don't understand that in heaven, everybody's not going to get the same thing. Everybody's not going to get the same reward. There are different rewards for different things. Now, those who are, whatever reward we're going to get is going to be based on a few things. It's going to be based on what we're called to. It's going to be based on our faithfulness to that call. It's going to be based on, you know, our motivation and all of those things. So God is going to take that work and he's going to put it to the test and look at it. Now, see, God knows everything. He knows everything. So you can do something and tell me or someone else, give us a reason for why you did it. But God goes behind all of that. He goes behind the veil. He goes behind the noise. He goes behind your talk. He goes behind you, your performance. And he sees the motive of your heart, why you did what you did. He's going to see that. Now, sincerity is okay, but it's not enough. Being sincere is not enough to keep you from suffering loss. Some people have the idea, if I do whatever I'm doing it for the Lord, and I'm sincere, I'm going to get a reward. I don't know what Bible you're reading, but it's not this one. You're not going to get something simply because you are sincere. Sincere is good, and it has its place. But what if you are sensing, give you an example. Paul, before he was Paul, when he was Saul of Tarsus, was sincere about putting Christians, locking Christians up and being there for them, watching them being put to death and so forth. He was sincere, but he was dead wrong. His sincerity didn't save him. No, no, and your sincerity is not going to save you. Somebody says, you know, well, God knows my heart. Well, that may be true, but that alone is not going to give you the reward. It's more to it than him just knowing your heart. Did you accomplish his will? Did you do what he called you to do? Did you do what he ordained for you to do? And you don't have to be a pastor or a minister like that, but God has a plan for your life. And one of the things I believe he's going to want to know is, did you follow my will or your own? Many people are doing all kinds of things for themselves. Everything they do is about them or them and their family. They don't consider God at all. They don't consider what he might want. But just because something seems good, I have a saying, every good idea is not necessarily a God idea. And every God idea is not necessarily his idea for you. Now, I'm going to show you something. I wanted to say this first. Well, instead of me telling you that story, let me go here first. Let's go to Acts chapter 16. I want you to see something. This is very, very important. Acts chapter 16. Praise God. Acts 16. In this particular place, we're going to see the will of God. Now, if I took you to Mark, the 16th chapter, starting at 15th verse, or just reading the 15th verse, most of us know what it says. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. We know that that's in the scripture, right? Amen. But just because that's in the scripture, that's not telling every individual to go all over the world to preach. That is a commission for the church, the worldwide church. But God may specifically and does specifically have something for you to do. God may use you on your job, in your school, in your neighborhood, in your community, in your family, and other things. That may be your world, if you will. That may be that for you. But God has a plan. And even if you are a minister and you have a worldwide ministry, you still have to do what God says. You cannot just decide, you know, we're pretty big. Let's go over here and go to this land. Let's go do some things over here. You can't do that. I mean, you can do that, but it's not going to mean that it's going to count for God, because that's just you doing something on your own. This is how serious this is, because the work that you do is going to be critically appraised. The worth and character of that work is going to be appraised by God. If the work survives the test, you get a reward. If not, you're not going to get a reward. Now let's look here let's start in verse 5 of 16. That's not necessarily the best place, but anyway, let's read that. And so were the churches established in the faith and increased in number daily. Now when they had gone throughout Persia and the region of Galatia, now listen to this, and were forbidden of the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia. Well, wait a minute. Didn't we just read or bring up what was in the scripture? Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Yet here we see they were forbidden by the Holy Ghost to go and preach the word in Asia. That's what I mean when I say every good idea is not necessarily a God idea, and every God idea is not necessarily his idea for you. He may have a specific place, and he does have specific plans for us, but he may have a specific plan or place for you to go, something for you to do, and that's where he wants you. You can't just decide, well, I'm going to go over here and do this work over here because they need it. Well, their need is not your call. Just because someone needs something, a need is not necessarily a call. Because they need it don't mean God wants you to go. And it's very interesting. This is one of the most interesting passages I've read, and I think is in the Bible. Because it really explains certain things, brings certain things out. God has a specific plan. He has a specific will. He has a specific desire for you, for me. If we have a ministry, he has a plan, a desire for that ministry. That's he has something for that. He has a special plan, desire for that particular church, for that pastor. Praise God. For the lead, whatever it is. But God has something to be done. You can't just decide, well, let's go do something. You know, for instance, I'll give you an example of something. There are ministries that sense a call of God to feed the hungry. And they have feeding programs and all that. Not everybody does that. Not everybody is commanded by God or even led by the Spirit of God to do that. But I can be a blessing to some other ministry that's doing it, even though I'm not doing that. So I still become partaker with them by helping them do it, while I do the thing that God has led me to do. And I may be doing some things someone else is not doing, and they may support me and help me do what I'm to do, you know, what the Lord has directed me to do. So let us understand, we're all on the same team. It's not some competition. It's really sad and foolish to be in competition with other people, other ministers or other churches, and there's a lot of that goes on. People comparing themselves to each other and measuring themselves by each other. I mean, it's ridiculous. You're not going to get a greater reward because you do a whole lot more stuff. You can do a whole lot. Movement is not progress. Movement is not progress. Just because you're doing something don't mean you're progressing in the things of God. You can walk for miles on a treadmill, and when you step off that treadmill, you're in the same spot that you were in before you started, and yet you walk for miles on the treadmill. You had a lot of movement, but you didn't go anywhere. You can be doing that in ministry, going just doing a whole lot of stuff. Just doing stuff. Whatever comes to your mind, you're just doing stuff. That don't mean it's God. That don't mean it's God. Just because you think it up in your head don't mean it's God. Just because it sounds exciting don't make it God. It doesn't mean that that's what he's leading you to do. And many are going to get in trouble with the law in this area right here. Right here. Did he tell you to do that? Is that what he led you to do? Is that your calling? Is that your purpose? Is that his plan? Is that what's in the book for you? That's what you have to consider. You can't just decide, I'm going to do whatever I want to do and think, and God's got to bless it. Lord, I'm doing this for you. No. You're not doing that for him, because this it's not possible to do something for him that he didn't tell you to do. You can't be doing it for God. Now, and let's finish with this, because I want you to see something. This blessed me when I every time I read it. All right, now notice this again, verse 6. Now, when they had gone throughout Persia and the region of Galatia, and were forbidden of the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia. That doesn't mean he didn't want the word preached in Asia. He forbade them to go to Asia. Why would God forbid them to go to Asia? Because he had a different plan. It's not up to you to do whatever you want to do. It's about knowing His plan, His will, and following it. If you ever get to that place, you will stop, you will relax and be at peace. I don't ever compare myself to anyone. I don't care what they're doing, how much they got, how many people come, how much money they, I don't care. That don't mean a thing to me. I just need to do what the Lord told me to do. Because when I stand before the judgment seat of Christ, He's not going to say, look what Reverend Tommy had or Pastor Tommy had. Look what he did and you didn't do as much. That's not what He's going to say. He's not comparing me to anybody. What He's going to do is look at me and judge me according to His plan for me and the work He put me over, His plan for that work, our ministry, since I'm over our ministry. What is His plan for our ministry? What is His plan for our work? What is His plan for our church? That's what I have to know, and that's what I have to direct. That's what has to happen. It doesn't matter what's happening around me anywhere else. You're not going to get a greater reward based on a larger work. You're going to get your reward on the basis of your faithfulness to your work. Every man must give an account of himself. Are you listening to me? You're going to have to give an account of yourself. So they wanted to go to Asia. They had already been traveling to Derby and Lystra and other places. And now they wanted to go here to Asia, but they were forbidden of the Holy Ghost. This is Paul and his company. Then verse 7 says, and they were come to Mysia. They essayed to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit suffered them not. So that means He did not allow them to go there. So that's two places they thought about going. But one, they were forbidden of the Holy Ghost, and the other, they were not permitted to go. And they, passing by Mysia, came down to Troas. And a vision happened, and a vision appeared to Paul in the night. Now, wait a minute. There's something to learn here. You know, I was a minister. I was a part of something, and there was other ministers involved. And the lead minister, we was talking about doing something, was supposed to be praying about something, some steps that we were going to take. And the lead minister came back and said, you know, he said, I prayed and I didn't get anything. And so I decided, excuse me? If you prayed and didn't receive anything, you don't move. You don't just say, oh, well, I'm going to do something anyway. This is what I think I'm going to do. And unless the Lord tell me different, this is what I'm going to do. What do you mean if He tell you different? Well, if you know Him that He's telling you different, why don't you wait until He tell you what to do from the start? See, people say that because they think God's going to do something, crack the sky open and throw a lightning bolt or something, and your room light up and you hear an audible voice, something major, something of the natural, being natural minded, looking for God to do something, natural to make you, to wake you up. Oh Lord, if this ain't really you, stop me from doing it. What do you mean? What is that? That's foolish. And I said to myself, I can't follow you across the street. You decide that you're going to pray about something and you didn't receive anything and you're going to move on anyway and do something. I'm not going to join in with that. I need to hear God. My pastor, the late Apostle Arturo Skinner, used to say all the time, he said, get the mind of God. What was he saying? He would tell us, you go pray about a matter. You pray until you hear from God. You pray and hear what God has to say about the matter. Don't just do something. Pray. Well, I prayed. So how long have you been praying? Did you receive nothing? Maybe there's some things hindering your ability to hear. Maybe there's a lot of other things going on. Praise God. Maybe that's the problem. Maybe you have some idea of how He has to lead you, instead of just letting him lead you in whatever way he chooses to. You can't just say, give me a dream. That may not be his will. He may want to do something else. Now, these men following Paul, they was trying to go here. Spirit of God wouldn't let them go. He forbade them to go one place and then wouldn't suffer them to go when they desired to go there. No. Why? Okay. So they were forbidden and wasn't led to go, wasn't allowed to go. But see, sometimes we're in a hurry and we need to be patient and wait to hear from him. And that's what happened in this case. Paul waited. Now, the Lord gave him a vision in the night. Now then, what's happening is the will of God is being revealed. What he actually wanted him to do is being revealed. Now, let me tell you something. Paul, what suppose they had gone to Bithynia? Suppose they had gone to Asia, the places that the Lord didn't want them to go. Put aside negative things that could have happened to them. Sometimes people get out of the will of God and it costs them their life. That's a fact. Sometimes they get out of the will of God and it costs them their life. Yes, yes. Sometimes people were in the wrong place at the wrong time and died. But if they followed the Lord, they would not even have been there. Some people just do whatever they want. They don't think about it. They go and do and whatever they choose. And they just assume everything is going to be all right. Sometime the Holy, that's why we have to get with him and get close to him and develop a relationship with him for ourselves so that he can lead us. He can guide us. Many years ago, I was, as a young minister, I was just starting out, and I was not a pastor or anything yet, but I was just starting out. And we used to, in our church in New York and in New Jersey, we had something called the prayer tower. And actually, this was in the church in Newark, New Jersey, at our temple, and we had a prayer tower. And I used to, and the prayer tower you could call 24 hours a day, you know, to receive prayer. And it was, at this time, it was on a voluntary basis, and I volunteered to do, you know, sometimes on a Saturday. And we would come, and, you know, I and this other brother was with me, and we would live in Staten Island. We used to travel all the way to Newark, New Jersey, to be a part of that thing. We had to leave like 6 o'clock in the morning and so forth like that. And he had been in the Lord longer than me, and I used to watch him. And he used to say to me, he said, brother, you have to be flexible. And he would, you know, he was a little dramatic with it. He said, but you gotta be flexible. You gotta move. And he'd move his whole body. You gotta move with the Spirit. You gotta be so flexible. Whichever way he goes, you go. That stuck with me though. That if you're too stiff, you may break. You need to be flexible. You gotta be able to go here and this way and go that way. That happens to me all the time in church. I'm planning to minister something, and I'm in the middle of preaching it, and the Holy Spirit just take me a whole nother way. And then someone come out to church and say, when you went that way, that was for me. I needed that. The Lord knows that. I don't do it intentionally. I'm not trying to do it. I don't plan to do it. But you got to be flexible. But just like in that, you got to be flexible in your life. Sometimes we make plans for ourselves and for our lives and all of that. We don't consult the Lord. And some of us are so cemented in what we want to do, if the Lord told you something different, you would have a problem. You would call it the devil and everything. You start rebuking the blood of Jesus, the devil is a liar. You'd be calling God the devil because you are so cemented in what you want to do. But we don't stop and pray and seek God and see if this is the way to go. He leads us by way of peace, not up in just in your head. Not in your head at all, actually, but in your spirit. That's how you know. I'll tell you something about that, and then I'm gonna get back to this, and we're gonna close in a few minutes. But you know, years ago, remember that we was coming up, we was in the 90s, and we was coming up on Y2K. It was all this big hoorah about Y2K. When the year, you know, 2000 come, this is going to happen, and that's going to happen. And pastors and ministers was telling people, you know, start, you know, getting water and batteries and this and that and the other and all of that. And I stood up in my church, and I said to the people, nothing is going to happen. Nothing is going to happen. I didn't save and encourage anybody else to save. Not one bottle of water, not one can of peas, not one bag of chips, nothing. Now, you say, well, did the Lord speak to you and tell you nothing was going to happen? Nope, he did not. How did you know? I knew that because I knew I had a peace on the inside. And see, we're supposed to be at peace, and then because the Holy Spirit leads us by that peace. And when something gets off, then that peace gets disturbed. That's what, how you know there's something that's disturbing my peace. That's how I know. What people do is the other way around. They try to get the peace after the stuff is going on. Now they praying, trying to get peace about it. And that's you got it backwards. That's the opposite way of it working. And I told the people, nothing's going to happen, and nothing happened. That doesn't make me something special. Any Christian could have done that if they were tuned in and know how to go with the peace of God. That peace told me nothing's happening, and I told the church, there is nothing that's going to happen. Nothing is going to happen. Nothing's going to happen. Now, I need to finish this story here, so let's go back to it. All right, now Paul had a vision, verse 9, and a vision appeared to Paul in the night. There stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, saying, come over into Macedonia and help us. See, now the plan is revealed. And after he had seen the vision, immediately we endeavored to go into Macedonia, assuredly gathering that the Lord had called us, the Lord had called us for to preach the gospel unto them. You see? Now, so they go to this place. They go here. And let's just keep reading. Therefore, loosing from Troas, we came with a straight course unto Samothracia, and the next day Neapolis, and from thence to Philippi, which is the chief city of that part of Macedonia. See, he saw a vision of a man saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. All right, now. So now they know from the Spirit of God that they're to go. The Lord showed him a vision. He could have did it a different way, but he gave him a vision. And he gave him a vision of a man saying, come to Macedonia and help us. So they went to Philippi, which is a chief part of Macedonia and a colony. And we were in that city abiding certain days. And they went on the Sabbath day, they would go in and cry out, you know, and do things and teach and do all these other things. Now, let's pick up verse 13. And on the Sabbath, we went out of the city by riverside where prayer was wont to be made. And we sat down and spake unto the women which resorted thither. And a certain woman named Lydia, a seller of purple of the city of Thyatira, which worship God, heard us, whose heart was open, the Lord opened, that she attended unto the things which were spoken of Paul. Now, I want to skip down. Verse 16. And it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. The same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. And this did she many days. But Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out the same hour. Now, when that happened, of course, those people, she couldn't tell fortunes anymore and all of this. To make a long story short, if we have time next time, we'll come back to it. But now Paul went there, and the woman, the damsel, is carrying on. She's a slave girl. She tells fortunes. She's making her masters a lot of money. Now that spirit that was in her couldn't tell fortune, and she couldn't tell fortune anymore because it was cast out. They, as a result, get thrown into prison. Now, they're in the will of God in prison. They got beaten, and they're in the will of God, got beaten and put in prison. But a man and his household got saved as a result. What if Paul had said, listen, let's go on to Bithynia or Asia anyway, even though we feel like the Lord is not saying go, let's go, because there's work to be done there. What if they had gone? And what if they had gone there and look at a positive side and won people to Christ, got people healed, got people delivered? What if they did all of that? All of that would have counted for nothing. It would not count when they stand before Jesus, because it is not according to his will. You could do a whole lot of stuff, religious work or church work or other work, and not be in the will of God. And let me tell you, anything you do that is inconsistent with what he wants you to do is done in vain. I don't care what kind of work it is or how good it is, or how big the crowds are, or how much money you got, or how many houses you got. None of that matters. If you didn't do or not doing what God designed and decided before you were born that you were to do, if you're not carrying out his plan and his will for your life, when you stand before God, it's going to count as nothing. Wood, hay, straw is going to be burned up, and you're going to suffer loss. And it's sad that many people are going to come to the Lord and say, look what I've done. I've done this and I've done that. And he's going to say, it doesn't mean anything. It's not what I told you to do. It's not what I led you to do. It's not what I called you to do. It's not what I sent you to do. You did what you chose to do on your own, and you called it doing a work for me. But really, it was for you, because you had an ulterior motive. You wanted fame. You wanted fortune. You wanted whatever it is, whatever your reason is. If it was not in line with the word of God, the will of God, in other words, I'm not just talking about you taking a Bible scripture and saying, this is it. I'm talking about what he has directed you to do, what he has called you to do, what he wants you to do. And if you don't know that, it's time for you to find out what that is. Because it's going to be a sad day at the judgment seat of Christ when people have such a great loss because they did so much in vain. Man, I'm out of time, but we're going to have to pick up here, because there's so many other things I want to tell you about that. I'm going to show you, you can be in ministry. I'm going to show you, you can be a pastor. I'm going to show you how you can do things as a pastor. You can start a church and all this, and it wind up being for nothing. Nothing. Amen. Praise God. I told you when we first started, fasten your seatbelt. So praise God. We're going to get back to some more next week by the grace of God. I don't know how long I'm going to be on it. I'm going to work this thing as long as the Holy Spirit leads me to work this. People need to understand this truth. We need to understand this truth. Praise God. And so we're going to talk about a number of things. We're going to talk about what's going to happen, and tears, and all of those kinds of things. We're going to talk about it, because it's going to be some crying. It's going to be some crying in heaven, praise God, at the judgment seat of Christ. It's going to be. But we're going to talk further about that next time by the grace of God. Father, we thank you again for the word. Thank you for bringing out the things as you have brought them out. I know there's so much more. I said what I believe I could say, and what I was led to say. And so I thank you, Lord. You know who's listening and what they need to hear, and so forth. And so I thank you. I thank you for ministering to people, and I thank you for arresting the attention of many, that they may stop and say, wait a minute, let me make sure that what I am doing is in line with the will of God, lest I work and live and die, and it's all in vain. I make it to heaven, but that's it. Oh, my, my, my. Thank you, Father, for your word, in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Now, if you're there and you don't know the Lord Jesus as your Savior, that message was not for you. That message was not for you at all. If you don't know Jesus, you're not going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. You're going to be standing at the white throne judgment. And that judgment, you don't want to stand at. And you're going to have to give an account of all of your life, all your sins and everything. You're going to have to give an account for it. And you're going to be thrown in the lake of fire. So don't die without Christ. Don't die without Christ. Don't die without Christ. And right where you are, if you're not saved, if you have not received them, I want you to raise your hands up right where you are. You don't have, if you're driving or whatever, well, if you're driving, you're listening and you're driving or something like that, then of course you can't raise your hand, leave it right on that steering wheel. But I want you to say within you, say it out so that you hear yourself say, "Oh God, I believe that Jesus is Lord. I also believe that you raised him from the dead so that I can be saved. I receive the Lord Jesus as my Lord, as my Savior, as my only hope of eternal life. In Jesus' name, I believe I pass from death to life. According to your word, I am saved." Praise God. God bless you. Thank you. And thank you for giving. It is time for you to, those of you that will support, praise God, all our members, you know, praise God, this is your time to support the work. Give and it shall be given unto you. So let's be faithful in our giving, and God is going to bless us. The same measure that you meet with all is going to be measured to you again. God bless you. On the screen, you'll find ways to support us, and I want to thank all of you that give to our work. Praise God. God is going to bless you as a result. Expect it, receive it in Jesus' name. Until next time, God bless you.